I guess my role is just to keep the panel rolling along, so I'll be somewhat of a taskmaster in terms of keeping you guys on time, and hopefully we'll save some time for question and answer so to get the audience involved. There's no particular rational order for things. And so I think the way we might want to do it is to start off with New York and end up in Los Angeles, because that's my flight home. And in that sense, we might also want to impose a little bit of a historical order on that. So starting with Peter, if that's okay.
Thanks, Paul. You really were on time. Surprised. Anyway, thank you. I'm supposed to talk about the future of ethnic communities. So my topic today is an exploration of the future of Chinatown, Manhattan's Chinatown. This is a popular and controversial and sensitive topic, but I hope I could bring some perspective on the different approaches to look at the future of Chinatown. Chinatown is not a fix, and it's not unchanging. It's always going through transformation. And a standard definition of Chinatown is a place where people, ethnic Chinese, work, live, shop, socialize. Now, the Chinatown 1970s come closest to this definition. At that time, due to the change in immigration law, a large influx of family-oriented immigrants come to live in Chinatown, work in Chinatown. Majority of these people were workers, along with small businesses, with small capitals, developing manufacturing in the community. So garment is one of the most important industry that developed during that period of time. And with the development manufacturer, it also boosts the growth of restaurant industries. So with these two industries at anchor, the community boom. The boom has also led to the influx of bilingual professional services to come to the community. So this then becomes, by late 70s, a formation of what sociologists call the enclave. Now, I'm going to jump very, very quickly. Today's talk is not going to be very refined, but I want to bring in some major ideas. Since the end of the 1990s, Manhattan Chinatown was faced with very serious economic crisis, mainly the collapse of the garment industry, the pillar of Chinese economy. That also led to the decline of the restaurant trade. So by the end of 1990s, looking up a community that's really in decline, it seems, as at least. Of course, 9/11 didn't help. So there was real sense maybe this community is gonna be changed to something very, very different. And so I would like to start kind of formulate. Since 9/11, there are three separate developments happened in Chinatown at the same time. The first is that many people looking at the problems the Chinatown faced, particularly the decline of garment industry and other small businesses, declines everywhere. You know, nowadays, even if you go to Mott Street, we see a lot of stores are not doing well, and used to be very, very thriving businesses. They're servicing Chinese clientele, now are kind of selling trinkets. And after 7 o'clock at night, very few people go in there. But if you look beyond that, however, if you walk around Chinatown, you will find something very interesting. Actually, Chinatown boundary may not have grown. the density of business have. So unbeknownst to all of us, people are talking about, well, you know, Chinatown this and Chinatown that. But the Chinese people, community residents, and business actually are reinventing themselves. If you look at the census figures, it shows from 2000 to 2010, there's a dramatic increase of new businesses. Right? And the businesses are diversifying now, many more than the older dependence on only garment and restaurant. Older businesses are also reinventing themselves, making themselves more efficient, more rational. And so what we are basically talking about then is that we have a new situation. Now, exactly as the first the first option, people basically saying, look, what Chinatown needs to do is to develop new business model. What Chinatown needs to do is to introduce American way of doing things, introducing technology, introducing more sophisticated businesses, maybe high-tech, maybe more sophisticated. Now, now this is one proposal many people have proposed. And consequences of that is to say, well, look, if we want to reinvent, change Chinatown the way that old business is operating, we should introduce investment. We should make the place more attractive to people, right? So this is a model that many people feel that we want a new Chinatown, we want more investment, we want to have a totally different kind of economy, economic base. So one of the proponents of this group is to say, well, you know, we should make this place attractive. BID is one of those, Business Improvement District is one of those proposals, right? Maybe we could bring the tourists back, we could strengthen our restaurant trades, we could have night markets, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this is one option. The other option is that many people realize that the 19 year after 9/11, American economy has gone through a tremendous readjustment, shifted more towards finance. With federal policy of low interest rate, this led to the acceleration of real estate industries. And so what you see is New York has been gentrified, but the first 10 years is really, really accelerated. So Chinatown becomes one of the last area that's ungentrified. And yet Chinatown is a very desirable area. It's close to Wall Street, it's neighboring to Tribeca and Soho. It has also a kind of exotic flavor as an ethnic community. So there are a lot of people feel that maybe we should, in fact, transform this area to a high-end residential commercial area. And many foreign as well as American developers are waiting on the sideline to see this change. And one of the things they want is changing zoning laws so they could have high rises and such. Now, so what they want to do is trying to make this area uh, uh, conducive, suitable for professionals, higher income people, and also business and commerce that's suitable to their taste, to their needs. So with this particular focus, then these people are basically want to change Chinatown and basically wanted to make it very much what we call to replace the existing residents and businesses. The third thing, as I said before, unbeknownst to most of us, actually Chinatown has grown. Business diversified, new business added into Chinatown. And they may not follow American business models, but they are creating jobs in the way that's rational to the kind of economic structure that exists in Chinatown. So let me just explain to you what some of the business. For instance, even in a very standard business, restaurant business is long in Chinatown, but Chinatown in recent years have developed restaurant business vertically as well as horizontally. That is, as you know, not only you have restaurants, you have supplies, wholesale, produces, all right? Produces come from Florida, produces come from New Jersey. You have, nowadays, we took over the Italian neighborhoods, AAARI, all the kitchen equipments. Then you have fixture stores selling chairs, selling lamps that fits in a Chinese restaurant, and so on and so forth. So these business is expanded. Now, another thing that's interesting enough that's developed on the road is the bus. In the old days, restaurant owners have these smaller buses to ship their workers to work in suburbs. And now this thing developed into buses, not only serving Chinese clientele, but now they have very, very extensive systems. But anyway, I'm just going to give you highlight some of these new developments. But there's another development that is Chinatown now becomes a supplier of new businesses developing outside Chinatown. So buffet is one development. So many buffets, almost every part of the East Coast, even as far as West Coast, mostly Fujianese. $7.99, all you can eat, right? The food, the interior design, everything is actually coming from the same copy, which is basically coming from Chinatown again. So the food supplies come from Chinatown. I live in, I have a house 3 hours drive from here. There's a Japanese restaurant. All right. Let me. Anyway, so this Chinese from Hong Kong serving sushi, serving Japanese stuff. Now I said, you know, you don't know anything about even Chinese food. Why? Well, everything comes from Chinatown. Every week, the sushi, the fish is cut, and all this kind of. So Chinatown therefore becomes a hub that is providing the know-how, providing supply, providing the financing to these development. And another development is businesses moving some of the outfits to the suburbs, following the Chinese professionals. Okay, just give me 2 more minutes. This is something very, very important. What I'm trying to say is, Chinese community have followed their own model of economic development. This economic development, we could go on and on to a lot of literature about it. It's very, very different from the West, which is mainly labor intense, but there is potential and capability of economic growth. That growth from divisional labor, refined divisional labor, right? So China was not a weak country at the end of the 18th century until industrial development happened in Europe. But the Chinese have proven themselves capable of change. People always talk about Chinese model is stagnant, backward, but it's not the case. So what I'm trying to say is the Chinatown in the last 10 years in New York also exhibit the same kind of pattern. Labor intense, refined divisional labor. Just talk about wedding industries, right? Wedding industries is not one company owns all these industries, but it's coordinated. They provide you a restaurant, they provide you photos, they provide a limo, they provide you a wedding hall, they provide you programs, et cetera, et cetera. So my suggestion to all of us is this. This kind of development, as small businesses, they are potentially able to be viable, but they are very vulnerable to economic developments. They're very vulnerable to gentrification. So any attempt to try to change this kind of equation will cause tremendous loss of residents as well as small businesses. Thank you. I'm sorry it takes so long.
Thank you. And actually, I learned a lot from your presentation. So, lightning. Darrel?
Thank you. Good morning. I want to begin by thanking Joyce Moy and AAARI for adding the Indo-Caribbean segment to this panel. And I want to ask the audience real quick, before today's conference, did any of you not hear the term Indo-Caribbean? Is this new to anybody in the audience? Good. Interesting. About half of the audience never heard Indo-Caribbean before. So let me begin by giving you a short synopsis of what Indo-Caribbean means. When slavery was abolished back in the 1830s, the black slaves basically walked off the plantations and refused to continue cutting sugarcane and harvesting rice, etc. So the British, the Dutch, the French, everyone was faced with a labor shortage. And what they did, they started hiring Indians into indentureship ship to come into the Caribbean and many other parts of the world. In 1838, the first boat came to Guyana, which is in South America, but economically and culturally, it's part of the Caribbean. And from 1838 to 1915, there was a steady stream. So today, throughout the Caribbean, there is about 2 million Indians or people of Indian origin in the Caribbean. Of course, there's been a second wave of migration starting in the 1960s. This migration was to the US, Canada, England, and Venezuela when Guyana became a communist country. And in Guyana, as they became a communist country, they banned all imports. And this was part of what was going on throughout the world in those days with the Cold War, where, you know, the Russians leading this this idea of communism. Part of it was trying to strangle America economically by taking away imports, because most of the imports, of course, the Indian people and the African people in Guyana, most of them decided, well, this is not going to work for me. And literally, between the first three decades of 1960, 70, and 80, half of Guyana migrated out of the country. Literally half of the population migrated. And most of them came to the US. But we're also talking about a larger group of Indians from the Caribbean. Trinidad and Tobago has the largest population of Indians in any single demographic in the whole world. And as such, the Indian government has made it their number one priority to help work and develop them. In New York City, we have about 223 people of South Asian descent, including Indo-Caribbean people. This current census puts the number at 53,000 in terms of their rules and how they put stuff together, they put their numbers together. Of course, it's an undercount. In the 2000 census, they agreed to establish an Indo-Caribbean task force so that we can have our own track within the census. The task force found 160,000 Indo-Caribbean people throughout New York City. All right, of course, because of the rules that the census follows, the current number is 53,000. I say that to say that within the South Asian community, the Indo-Caribbean people is not only the largest segment within the South Asian community, but we are also the ones who have been here for the longest. We have been the ones who have had the most impact. However, because of the rise of India, Indians in America as a whole, South Asians, have become very big. And that has awakened the 160,000 Indo-Caribbean people in Richmond Hill, in South Ozone Park, in Kew Gardens, in Ozone Park, in Woodhaven, Long Island, the Bronx, Castle Hill, all these places where there are large numbers of Indo-Caribbean people. And this now speaks to the future of the Indo-Caribbean people. But in talking about the future of the Indo-Caribbean people, I want to talk a little bit more about who we are in terms of identity. One of our leading nonprofits is called Rajkumari Center for Indo-Caribbean Culture. It's one of those organizations that continue to contribute in a large way to the community by doing two things: continuing to teach the culture, but more importantly, finding custodians in the Caribbean and bringing them here to New York City for long periods of time, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, to teach specific parts of the culture. For instance, one of the things that has happened over the last 174 years since the first boat arrived was that the Indians in the Caribbean was isolated from India. So what happened, the culture that they brought with them has stayed alive here. And that culture, if you try to find it in India, it's very different today, because in India it has evolved. For instance, everybody within the South Asian community know what Chautal music is. It's basically 5,000-year-old music that you sing around different events like weddings and pujas, which are prayer sessions and so on. And this music, as it is in the Caribbean, is as it was in India in the 1800s. Okay? Dr. Peter Manuel, who teaches right here at the Graduate Center, is an ethnomusicologist. And since 1980, he has been researching Indo-Caribbean music. And he is hard-pressed to find stuff. For instance, one instrument called a dantal, which is a piece of iron that's tuned and shaped to make chautal and other types of music. He can't find it in India anywhere. He spent 3 months in India, in the Bhojpuri region and Calcutta, trying to find this instrument. And now we're trying to figure out who invented it, where was it created. But this is uniquely Indo-Caribbean. Okay? We also have today a transference of culture, as I was alluding to, and lifestyles that come with us here to New York City and in other places in America where we have large populations like South Florida and Houston. And one of the things, as I said earlier, we've been here for 5 decades in large numbers, but we've basically been within our own enclave. And what has happened over the last previous 4 decades before, let's say 2001, 9/11, let's use that as a marker. Before 9/11, everything that was happening culturally just basically happened within the community, all right? One of my objectives in the last decade, in fact more than a decade, was to expand that, myself and others, by building relationships with AAARI. Dr. Tam, when he started, he invited me to be part of AAARI. I came, I realized what they were doing, and I decided I needed to be part of AAARI. I began by volunteering. And of course, as part of the process, talking about who we are as Indo-Caribbean people. Indo-Caribbean youth in particular has driven the new awakened political, civic engagement, and pushing out beyond our enclave in the last decade. So we're talking about the first generation growing up in an America and identifying differently than their parents did, living differently than their parents did. The Indo-Caribbean is what we all are, but as an individual looking at themselves, are they Guyanese? Are they Trinidadian? Are they Indian? Are they American? Interestingly, Indo-Caribbean is not a word used in the Caribbean. In the Caribbean, we are all Indians. Of course, in America, Indian means something different. Right? So, you know, the task force, before the task force, we identified this is what we should use, Indo-Caribbean. And that's where we have come 10 years later. And now, what has happened is that this idea of Indo-Caribbean has transferred back to the Caribbean. So people at the University of the West Indies, the University of Trinidad and Tobago, the University of Guyana, the University of Suriname, these folks are all now adding the title Indo-Caribbean to their language and their programming. Some of the things that make us who we are as a community, we're very hardworking, industrious, entrepreneurial. The culture drives our lifestyle. For instance, one of the things that's very big is fetes, having a party. We will use any excuse to have a party, all right? So throughout the spring, summer, and into the fall, every weekend there are a lot of parties. And that's a big part of our culture, all right? Cooking competitions associated with a party is a big part of our culture, all right? We have a roti cooking competition, a curry cooking competition, maybe just duck curry, cooking ducks. Anybody ever had curry duck?
No.
Just a few people? You got to come to Richmond Hill and try it. I will send Joyce a recipe so she can forward it to you all to try it. But if you want the authentic thing, come to Richmond Hill, South Ozone Park. Some of the other features of our community, for instance, we have more than 50 Hindu temples in South Queens. Okay? That's more than all the Hindu temples for all the other South Asians in New York City combined. Okay? That's very, very interesting to me. And for the most part, they're all doing very well, which means, you know, of course, the largest segment of our population, the Indo-Caribbean population, is Hindu. But this is just to give you a little highlight about who we are as a people. You know, those are many good things that I mentioned, but we also have problems that have transferred from the Caribbean. For example, domestic violence is still a big part of the community, a big problem. Now, in the last decade, we've had a lot of people, young people, and one or two older heads who are speaking out about domestic violence and bringing out this silent epidemic. So there are very encouraging signs that things are going to change. Another one of the negative is the drinking culture, all right? I think for most colonial people, or people who were colonized, drinking is something that is very endemic within the society, and that has transferred. So in 2008, when the crash happened, between then and now, the businesses on our main strip, which is Liberty Avenue between Vanwick Boulevard and Woodhaven Boulevard, Vanwick Expressway and Woodhaven Boulevard, that's our main shopping strip. It's also bordered by Rockaway Boulevard and 101 Avenue, which are also shopping strips. But the turnover, one-third of the businesses has seen a turnover in that period since the crash. But interestingly, none of the bars, none, zero, went out of business, okay? But also, I mean, cricket is very big in the Caribbean, and it's very big here. The Indo-Caribbean community, we have more than 50 cricket teams, softball cricket teams, and that, again, is also more than the rest of the South Asian community combined. So in terms of who we are, that gives you a snapshot. So now that I have a couple of minutes left, let me come back to the future. I began by saying that I'm very, very encouraged in the last decade with the first generation. We have folks within the community who has a new Americanized mentality while still participating and holding on to their Indo-Caribbean culture. And from that has sprung the idea that, look, who we are is great. Let's push it out there. Let people know. Let's get more involved. And a lot of organizations have popped up, like the Indo-Caribbean Alliance, which was founded by two 20-something-year-olds, and they're doing great work in the community, and they're building bridges with other organizations outside of the community, like I have done for more than a decade. And I think my work shows clearly that there is a need to say who we are. There's so much value there, and there's so much that we have brought to New York City. When we began living in Richmond Hill and South Queens, it was very depressed. And one of the things that happened is that we revitalized the whole community by bringing in, you know, whenever new immigrants come into a community, that always happens. The same thing happened in Richmond Hill, South Ozone Park, South Queens, Ozone Park. And in terms of civic participation, in the Caribbean, it's very low. The same thing has also transferred, all right? For instance, our leading poll, Mr. Albert Baldeo, who has ran for state senate, state assembly, and city council, never won. He came very close once. But the most votes he ever got was under 3,000, just under 3,000. So one of the great things that I see is that new young crop of first-generation Indo-Caribbean people are driving voter participation and civic participation. So that is very, very encouraging. The other thing that I must mention is that within this last census, All Deaf, who has always been a champion of the Indo-Caribbean people for more than two decades, and I have to applaud them for that. I think most of you have heard of All Deaf, the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund, Glenn McPante in particular. They have tried very, very hard for the last two decades to include us in their exit polling and in all of their programming. And this time around, when they created the unity map for the new census, they created one zone for the Indo-Caribbean people. And I'm encouraged that it seems that this is going to be approved. And this will put us in a position to really put our stamp on the political process. I thank you for having me here. I can provide more information. I will give Joyce Moy links for anyone who is interested in continuing to pursue information and a relationship with the Indo-Caribbean people. And any PhD candidates who wants to do research, I'm happy to help. Thank you.
I'm here just to talk to you about my observations doing community economic development work in historic Filipino town in LA and some of the lessons we're learning. And I really appreciate this opportunity because as community practitioners, we don't often get the chance to kind of reflect on our work, kind of think about where we're going and think about it strategically. And these talks and preparing for these talks really allow us to do that. So thank you for giving me that opportunity. I hope it's as interesting and relevant for you this morning. Just very briefly, historic Filipino town, the region of the city of LA, which is considered historic Filipino town, has been a traditional entry point for a lot of different immigrant groups over the years. It really emerged as an enclave for Filipino Americans after World War II. There was an original enclave near downtown, but post-World War II redevelopment kind of displaced that part of that community, and they made their homes in the area that we call historic Filipino town now. It got that designation by the City of LA in 2002. Just recently, we got a National Preserve America Community designation, which for those of you folks who aren't familiar with the program, it's kind of like Historic Preservation Light. It gives you some recognition. It's been helpful to us for marketing purposes, and it's just a nice honor to receive. The current population is about 60% Latino, mostly from Central America. Filipinos continue to be about 25% of the population, but it's important to understand that Filipinos were never the majority population in this area, and that has implications that I'll discuss in a moment, and 50% other communities. Despite the fact that it's not the population center for over 400,000 Filipinos that live in Southern California, it continues to be the historic center for the community. And if you go there, I'll show some pictures in a moment, but you'll see a lot of the institutions that continue to thrive, churches, and different organizations that continue to call that area home. I should mention that more recently, in terms of the economic history of the area, the neighborhood is on the southern end of what's called Echo Park in Los Angeles, which is basically the center of hip in LA now. It's become a truly kind of gentrified area of the city. But we were always on the southern end of it, and throughout most of the 90s, we were able to avoid the kind of gentrification forces that really transformed other parts of the city. That started to change in the 2000s and mid-2000s. And from SIPA's perspective of our work, we noticed that change when we noticed the types of dogs being walked in the neighborhood. There was a dramatic change. We started seeing designer breeds and you know, purebred dogs, and we realized this neighborhood is really transforming. But that change was quickly eclipsed when the market, when the economy went south and the housing market kind of collapsed in LA. However, we feel it's just a matter of time before those same types of forces come to our community. This just gives you a sense of some of the scale of the neighborhood. It's roughly 2.5-3 miles long and about a mile wide. That little picture, that little map in the top right kind of shows you where we're positioned. The big yellow community, that's Koreatown, and just to the east of us is downtown LA, and that brown area is Chinatown. And that purple area up there is actually Thai Town in the Hollywood area of LA. This is a little map that we use for marketing purposes to kind of show you the different sites and the things you'll see in historic Filipinotown. I think a couple things that's interesting about historic Filipinotown is it's not just a center for Filipino American culture, but you'll find other interesting historic places. Occidental Studios is the longest running and oldest film studio in LA, and it's actually located in the neighborhood. Interestingly enough, the Christian Pentecostal movement traces its roots to a house in historic Filipinotown. And that house still plays an important role in that religious movement. These are some of the sites you'll see in the neighborhood. We have a mural that, we, as far as we know, is the largest Filipino-American themed mural in the country. We have, as far as we know, again, the only monument dedicated to Filipino-American veterans. In the lower right, that's the Filipino Christian Church, which was founded in the 1930s and is still a thriving parish. These are just pictures of different events you'll see in historic Filipinotown throughout the year. So I work for Search Involved Filipino Americans. We have a 40-year history of doing community work in the neighborhood. And since the 90s, the last 20 years or so, doing community economic development work. And I think what we're finding in that, having done that work, is as a neighborhood-based kind of advocate and developer and service provider, we're seeing that the interests of stakeholders in our neighborhood, and this is very simplified, but can kind of be broken down in these three different categories. There are folks who see historic Filipinotown as a center for community economic development that are really interested in figuring out how do we improve conditions for local residents, how do we create a vibrant economic base, and in particular, I should mention, how do we deal with poverty? Historic Filipinotown still has, amongst like other parts of the inner city in LA, some of the highest poverty rates in LA County. And then there's another another element of the community that's really concerned about maintaining it as a center for historic and cultural preservation. Again, maintaining all those sites that you've seen, maintaining it as a community center, even if it isn't a population center, really just making sure that the history of, and the impact Filipinos have had in the neighborhood isn't forgotten. And then finally, and the one most complex for us to deal with, is those folks who see historic Filipinotown as a center for political empowerment. If you look at kind of the representation of Filipinos in the city of LA, we are actually the largest Asian population in the city of LA. But you wouldn't know that if you were to look at city politics and you were to look at our representation in the city council and amongst high-level staff people and officials in city government. And so people really want to change that. But folks who want to do that work, sometimes their interests may not necessarily be aligned with other interests in historic Filipinotown. Now, ideally, these interests, you know, aren't mutually exclusive, and certainly we've been able to work with different elements of the community to kind of bring these interests together and to find common agendas to fight for. This is just a list of the neighborhood-based organizations in historic Filipino town. This is not a complete list. This is just some of the organizations that play a role in advocacy, organizing, and service provision in the neighborhood. And they represent kind of a diverse grouping of folks. And again, they represent those, they can be broken down generally into those three areas of interest that I mentioned. And you know, historic Filipino town, the population is about maybe 25,000 total, 25% Filipino, so 7,000 Filipino, and yet you have all these organizations. And sometimes relationships can get kind of tough and testy, depending on what issue we're dealing with. So this is just a number, it's not scientific, I just kind of throw out. What I've found is 75% of the time, those organizations that I mentioned are probably all on the same page in terms of what we're trying to do in historic Filipino town and what development we want to see and what issues we're working on. But there is, you know, 25% of the time where we're really butting heads on a lot of these issues. And where we actually see a lot of that conflict arise is obviously around development. What kind of development and for whom? We currently in historic Filipino town, there's a 2.4 acre city block that currently has a basically underused warehouse on it. It's unheard of to have this kind of this land available for development in this city so close to the center of LA. There's going to be a real battle to see what happens to the city block. We were actually part of a development partnership that was going to turn it into a mixed-use project that would include housing that was mixed housing, mixed-income housing, as well as some commercial and retail space. But when the market died again in 2007, 2008, that project went south. So that property is now on the market, and we're really interested to kind of follow what's going to happen to that and what kind of impact it's going to have in the neighborhood. I mentioned the bicycle battle because I think that's one of the more concrete battles we've had recently that really kind of shows where people are lined up in historic Filipino town. The LA Bicycle Coalition is pushing a plan to really make LA bike friendly, and they came to our neighborhood and asked SIPA to help facilitate a meeting to talk about what plans they wanted to do in historic Filipino town that we could hopefully get on board and advocate for. And one of the things they wanted to do was just turn a couple streets into bike friendly lanes, get rid of some car lanes, make wider bicycle lanes, and for us that made a lot of sense. I mean, for low income folks, that's one of the only ways they can get around. We have a childhood obesity epidemic we're dealing with, and anything that gets people out of their cars, gets them active, we thought it was a good thing. Well, lo and behold, in this meeting, we're battling folks. Great, thanks, Paul. We're battling folks who think that this is not a good thing, that it's gonna. They want to see more cars because they think that's going to bring business to historic Filipino town and so forth. We've seen a lot of conflict when it comes to ethnic relations, especially around issues of redistricting. That I know there's a panel later this afternoon that I'd love to kind of hear about because that's definitely been a hot issue, particularly, again, because the majority of the population in historic Filipino is actually Latino or Hispanic. And there's also issues around generational and sectarian conflict. We definitely have different layers of leadership in the community. We're always trying to empower college students and young folks to get involved, but sometimes they have trouble kind of understanding where our first generation leadership is coming from, and we see that play itself out a lot in the community. So these are basically the things that we're trying to do as SIPA to strategically move forward and to hopefully be a positive player in the development of historic Filipino town. One is we're trying to really move the community around a common vision, trying to build some common ground and some bridges around a vision of historic Filipino town that addresses all those three interests, poverty, community economic development, historic preservation, and building a political power base. We're really concerned about building alliances with non-Filipinos. We feel like that's crucial to our future. But there's within the Filipino community, there's even differences on what that means. And probably the most important thing we're trying to do is build a pipeline of future leaders to continue this work and to continue doing the work that SIPA does. And that means working with students, getting young people involved, because ultimately building that human resource capital is what's going to have a long-term impact. So thank you very much. I'm more than happy to answer questions. And if you have questions about SIPA, please let me, please don't be afraid to approach me later. This is just, Manny Pacquiao is there on the right. He, as you know, is world champion boxer, and he visited SIPA last year, and it was really kind of a great celebration for the community. So I just kind of wanted to end on that positive note.
Okay, thank you, Dennis. It's amazing the dynamics that's happening in Los Angeles. As you saw from Dennis's map, many of our Asian American communities and enclaves are clustered around downtown, which poses enormous challenges in terms of what to do. At the same time, there's the development of the suburban enclaves, and they have a very different set of challenges, although many things in common in terms of identity, culture, and so forth. Dennis, next time the Pac-Man's in, let me know. Okay, so now I want to open this up to questions, comments from the audience. It would be great to have additional insights into other neighborhoods and communities in terms of the challenges for the future, as well as questions that cut across the three speakers. So we could do some comparative analysis. Why don't we start with? Oh, Betty, you could sit there and ask a question if you want.
We make an exception for Betty.
So why don't we start with Betty?
Ask one question of Darrel.
Sure.
And that is, what is your identity? Caribbean, Guyana, the Trinidad.
Very good question. Very good question.
American, and does that transfer across generations, especially in America? Do your second generation identify as American?
I'm so glad you asked. Let me talk about myself first. I was born in Guyana to a Trinidadian mother and a Guyanese father. At 7, we moved to Trinidad. So I grew up in Trinidad, where I spent my formative years and early adulthood. And I've been here for 15 years. So I identify as Guyanese, Trinidadian, American, and Indo-Caribbean. So I literally am it all. However, there is basically two identities living within the Indo-Caribbean community here in New York City. You have the older immigrants who wholly identify as either Guyanese or Trinidadian or Surinamese or Jamaican or St. Vincent, wherever they came from, even Belize. And the younger folks, of course, first identify for the most part as American. But they all participate in the Indo-Caribbean culture. And of course, when they're growing up, as teenagers, they're forced to participate in it, right? And a lot of them rebel. We've had suicides in the community because of this conflict. And we've had, well, not had, we have a crisis where young people are living two lives. In the house, they're one thing. They're living the life the parents expect, and outside, they're something else. And, you know, reconciling both is very difficult for them. And that really only happens when they get into college and meet other like-minded people and then find their own voice. So to answer your question, it's very complicated. Everybody identifies differently. However, I will say that they all identify and accept the term Indo-Caribbean.
Thank you. So why don't we turn to the mic? Over.
Hi, good morning. My name is Muntasir. I'm a student in anthropology at Teachers College, uptown. I guess I'll target this question to Mr. Arguelles. I was very keen on understanding better the sense of we, because first of all, you said the Filipino community is only a minority in this area in Los Angeles. So, for example, the bike battle, in what sense is there a we? How does a we develop, and what do we do? I'm just trying to get the sense of the civic collective that you're talking about, and how that forms.
I think you've just identified a topic for just a PhD dissertation. I don't know if I can completely answer the question, except that, well, let me describe the we that I'm talking about in Stark Filipinotown, which is that there is a sector of the community in that neighborhood that identifies as Filipino American, and that brings us together, and we come together on that basis. But what that ultimately means in terms of our vision for the neighborhood, what kind of projects we want to support, that, as I mentioned, can diverge into a million different directions. Now, you know, there's always talk about, sectarianism in the Filipino-American community. Is it worse than other communities? There's something to be said about the colonial history that we have that's impacted our community politics today. I don't think it's any worse or can't be any more overcome than any other community, but it is a challenge, as it is in all communities. And so SIPA is striving to kind of find that common we that's going to bring people together around the broadest agenda. But it is a challenge.
Let me just broaden that question to include the other panelists. One of the biggest challenges in terms of action and agency is how does one go about transforming a group in itself into a group for itself? And what usually is meant by that, a group in itself, is somehow it shares a material position, a fate, a common fate. And it could be economic, political, it could be social. A group for itself is one that can actualize through action and promote and try to come about, change the trajectory in a agenda that is conducive to that group. So two parts, again for the panelists, building on the original question, is how do you go about making those transmission, and what are some of the challenges both internal to that group and from outside?
I think you are asking a very important question, which is basically from American point of view, there's community, there are groups, there are leadership, particularly in time of crisis. What I think the Chinese community Chinatown exists for 120 years or more. Its structure's never been a one single community. They are considered Chinese as a reactive identity, but their operational premise is basically associations, groups, trades, and oftentimes they are not really in any form could be organized in a very efficient, effective way. So that's one of the disadvantage. When a lot of us, people coming out outside, look, this is Chinatown, we need to do this, we need to do that. But the Chinese, they're doing things on their own, separate organizational structures, and so they can't react to this. So a lot of the problems that's going on in Chinatown is not articulated as a group, and they don't react as a group. And I think this is a social issue rather than a... So that is a problem. For instance, people try to tell them to do all kinds of things, right? But they're doing things. They're doing their own things, right? People don't understand what they're doing, but they're doing it. So that's why I'm saying, last 10 years, they reinvented themselves. They find ways to solve problems. Not the kind of way that you like, but they can't even explain what that is all about. So I think this is one of the disadvantages, that everybody want to solve problems for Chinatown and not even noticing what they're doing to solve their own problems.
Hi, good morning. I have a question for Professor Kwan. You said earlier that other businesses are reinventing themselves to be more efficient and rational. Can you give an example of that? And this, I have another question, which is, what is your vision for the future of Manhattan's Chinatown?
Okay, I'll answer your second question first.
That's better.
That is, there are many, many different perspectives to look at Chinatown. Let me just tell you what my position is. My position is that my focus is on the people who are living in Chinatown, the business that's existing in Chinatown. So my perspective is, how do we sustain this community so the people don't have to be forced to move out? The business could go on, and the economy could be viable. That's the fundamental perspective I have, right? So you know, there's all kinds of things we could suggest Chinatown to do, but if the trade-off is not maintaining the people living there, small business survival, then I think there's a problem with it. All right. Now, insofar as diversity rationalization, you know, I didn't get a chance to talk extensively. I use the example of wedding. Wedding, you know, if you go on the Bowery, you see all these big wedding shops, right? And I have the opportunity to talk to some of these people. When you go there, you tell them, I want to get married on such date, where, and all that. Now, they take care of everything. It's a package deal, right? They tell you where the restaurant is going to be, what kind of dish is going to be in the restaurant. If you want more expensive, you da-da-da-da-da, right? They will give you photographers. They will provide you flower arrangements. They will provide, you know, I mean, I don't know whether you've been to some of these weddings. They have programs, some MC telling stories and get people excited and all that, all right? So everything is arranged, but that company does not own all these companies. That company is a coordinator. So in this sense, then, you know, in the old days when you want to get married, you have to do all these things by yourself.
2 days.
All right? And it's a pain in the ass. But however, now you have this kind of arrangement, all is taken care of. All right? And another thing, it's about wholesale, right? That, as I mentioned to you, well, you don't have to worry about, you know, this guy in the Japanese restaurant in upstate New York, right? You have these lamps that looks Japanese. It's made in China, right? But you don't, I mean, even if I don't know what the Japanese lamps look like or Japanese table looks like or the kind of cats, right? Well, it's all in that China. I mean, these things exist in Chinatown. There are stores in Chinatown sells these stuff specifically for people who are operating Japanese restaurant, who are Chinese, right? So what I'm trying to say is the refinement of the division of labor make doing this kind of small business much easier to get started. That's what I'm talking about.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Bobby Lee, and I think I'm probably the only active Asian American in AARP. So, as you guys were talking, it kind of brings out the fact that I am the only one. When I was lobbying up in Albany, New York this past spring, I was the only Asian up there. And it's odd, but it's fascinating. And fortunately, I'm well-versed, and I make myself home up there. But the opposite...
What are you lobbying?
For AARP, we lobbied for EPIC. All right? I don't know if some of you don't know what EPIC is because you're not old enough. But for those of us who are, and it's the donut hole in Part D in Medicare, and it was deleted last year in 2011. And in 2012, we restored it, but unfortunately, you have to survive to 2013 to actually use it. So, but I mean, it was just one item, and it's something that the AARP lobbyist was saying never happened before, ever. So I really appreciate the observations that Peter made about the transition of Chinatown and these observations probably are very important for the economic development and how Chinatown will transition, because everything in life transitions. And Darrel's observations about the Indo-Caribbean community, I think, apply throughout all the ethnicities of AAARI, in that we lose our ethnicity. I mean, I'm only 62, but I was born here, and I have really no relationship to the Asian community, because I was just part of the American culture. And I think that's something that we have to push forward, because as Peter said, as I'm the only active Asian American in AARP, I think, in the city of New York, that we need to have something that the, at least the Chinese community, can hang on to and say, hey, I'm Chinese. We don't have really Chinese music out there that pushes anything. So maybe that could be one way to get the young people to get into this. But I think you guys are doing a great job, and I hope this continues.
Thank you for those comments. Over there.
Good morning. My name is Nico Daswani, Program Director at the Asian American Arts Alliance. I have a couple of quick questions. First to Dennis, I was wondering if you might be able to expand a little bit more on the relationship between the Filipino and the Latino community communities in that neighborhood, and if there's any resentment at all from Latino residents with, you know, being a majority in a neighborhood which is, you know, preserved as a community for another ethnic group. And then for Darrel, a question I've been wondering for many, many years, when the West Indies play against India in cricket, who do you support and who does the community want?
Well, I'll be quick because I think that's the more interesting question. But we've, as an institution, my organization, we've been able to build good relationships with the Latino population in the neighborhood. But that doesn't mean the entire Filipino community has a good relationship. We're very cognizant of the fact that, yeah, we are not the majority of that neighborhood. On the other hand, you know, we also share a lot of things culturally, you know, Catholicism, all the things that, you know, kind of we can kind of bond with Latinos on. So we've tried to play a bridge-building role, because there are folks, again, trying to build it up as a power base for Filipino-American community without, I feel, personally feeling that they're not truly respecting the majority of the residents, which are, again, Latino. So it's a contentious issue that we kind of deal with on a regular basis.
To answer your question, for 20 years, the West Indies was the number one team in the world. Literally nobody ever beat them for 20 years. And this is a time when I grew up listening to cricket, watching cricket, playing cricket. So obviously, I'm a West Indian. However, I must say that more and more, I'm becoming more of a Trinidadian fan than a West Indian fan. All right, because of the politics, the selection process is very political in the Caribbean now. We are not getting the best teams representing the West Indies, which is why it's fallen. And this is really not talked about a lot in the news by any of the news media, including those in India. So that's a serious problem we have, and the reason why we've fallen as far as we have. We're probably the fifth or sixth best team in the world now, which is not good in my opinion, but the opposite is happening in Trinidad, where they're literally picking the best players to represent in every position. So Trinidad has risen and risen and risen, and for the last decade have been at the top of Caribbean cricket. This year, the Champions League, which is the biggest, become the biggest and the most watched cricket Champions League of 2020 in India, is the last. This is going to be the fourth year, and Trinidad has been in three of them. So we've represented the West Indies in three of them. We're coming back this year. The first iteration, we came second. And of course, we are now as big in India as we are in the Caribbean. So I'm very happy about that. And there's talk of breaking away, Trinidad breaking away and becoming an individual country. And there's a lot of political stuff going on there. But I like the question you asked, and I appreciate it. Thanks.
Oh, okay.
I just wanted to make a quick comment about Professor Kwong's earlier point about greater efficiency in Asian American businesses in the different towns. I'm actually getting married in a few months, and my fiance and I decided to go with a company in LA Koreatown, and in one afternoon we knocked out who's going to provide our dress, who's going to provide the tuxedos, the flowers, the photography, the makeup. It was tremendous. And the interesting thing is while we were there, we started looking around and we realized that there was only one other Korean couple there that day. There were white couples there, there were Latino. I can truly vouch for the fact that, yeah, these businesses are becoming efficient, they're learning how to market themselves, and they're making people like me very happy in terms of what they can provide.
Congratulations.
This is a very enjoyable panel. We have gone global, we've cut across arenas, including sports and weddings. What more? Okay, over there.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to congratulate AAARI and Joyce for this topic. This is a very unique topic. I myself, many years, I have been going to Chinatown, so many meetings, many, many action meetings. I involved with Lower East Side, Waterfront, and that time I was with on the board with Margaret Ching, because at that time I find a place, you know, like Martin Luther King, you know, in March. If more Chinese get together in a place, East River, when I see so many Chinese, I feel more Chinese, the more, you know, Asian American, more and more feel strong identity. And then I involve all Lower East Side and also the Chinatown Working Group, and Anthony Wong also, we together serving on community board too, and the Chinatown Working Group, and Anthony also served co-chair Chinatown Working Group. And the thing I want to share with you, so ownership, when I see this place, it's ownership. This is my place. That's why, you know, Darrel mentioned about where you are, where you feel comfortable yourself. And Peter just mentioned about something, the Chinese, so many things, but I just want myself. You know, this is very, very conflicting, and you want to swallow the whole universe. But on the other hand, that's why the globalization gradually expanding. And this is why we Asian, so lucky to have a Jerome Lin. Everybody can claim part of Jerome Lin. So it's first time American always stereotype Asian American. This is the first time Asian play on the NBA, impossible, but he is. And I also appreciate the whole panel, you know, Professor Ong and Darrel, Dennis, and Dr. Kwong. And I appreciate very, very much. I challenge four of you. How can you convert, transform, just like, you know, Dennis mentioned about transform the place to develop economic development, and cultural preservation, and historic cultural preservation, number two. Number three, the political empowerment. This is three, from the cultural and identity, and transform, produce, action plan, detail, program, issues. Thank you.
Okay, that's a great last question and a challenging one. So, panelists.
You know, my vision, what I talk about is very different from yours. I'm just talking about working class people, small businesses. They come to a new country. It's very, very difficult. They want to survive. They find different means, finding niches, and finding different ways to work in order to survive. And Geraldine and all this kind of stuff, that's fine. But that's not the issue. The issue is, right now, their business has been threatened, right? And so what my talk is basically, I want you guys to appreciate this, that they have their way of doing things, may not be what you like We would like to see high tech. We would like to see all kinds of jazzy stuff going on in Chinatown. But these are immigrants. This is first generation immigrants. This is where they live. This is where they work. This is where they socialize. And I think my feeling is that we should respect that. We should somehow help to protect that. I don't have any grandiose, and I think people living there is not this grandiose stuff, but it's the hardship of being an immigrant. Many of them not well educated, do not speak English. This is the only place they could live. This is the only place they could survive, all right? So anyway.
Thank you for your question. I'll give you two parts, pre-9/11 and post-9/11. Pre-9/11, transformation happened through economics. The Indo-Caribbean people, one of the things that we brought from India, in addition to the food and the culture, the flora and the fauna, is the desire for education and home ownership. And through that economic drive, we have transformed South Queens. For instance, I mentioned in the 60s and 70s when we started coming in larger numbers, the entire area was depressed. And through this new economic empowerment within our community, we have increased the values of homes. One of the things, for instance, is that throughout the Caribbean, you see a lot of wrought iron fences, intricate, ornate, beautiful wrought iron fences. Now, South Queens, every other house has intricate wrought iron fences, just like the Caribbean. And more than any other neighborhood in the whole country, there's more ornate, intricate wrought iron fences in Queens, and that has transferred. Surrounding neighborhoods, for example, Howard Beach. Howard Beach, you begin to see that now. Howard Beach is mainly Irish, Italian, white folks. So they see it, they love it, and they want it. And it's available widely in our community. There are craftsmen who are doing this every day. And Lindenwood and Rego Park, you're beginning to see it now. So post 9/11, as I mentioned, and you know, in the short thing I put here, a new awakening, through the first generation who are now civically engaged and taking a different direction than their parents did, I am looking forward to expanding our influence. So that has already begun because, for those of you who don't know, there's a very large population of Punjabis that's moved into Richmond Hill in the last 15 years. There's like 5 Gurdwaras and more coming up. There's about 20,000 Punjabi Sikhs who have moved into the community. And more we are seeing more Bangladeshi people moving in. There is a large population of Bangladeshi in Ozone Park. And we are having an impact on them because the resources they need, we have had it established already. They can walk into a store and buy saris or shalwars or whatever, stuff like that, and get Indian foods. And what we have seen in the last decade is Indian stores, as well as Sikh stores and Sikh families opening a large amount of business, particularly in the last 4 years when I said 1/3 of the businesses has turned over. So that's what we're seeing now, and this is what I'm looking forward to the future. Thanks.
Let me just say that, I think we're on the same page in terms of how do we bring together political empowerment, economic development, cultural preservation to really assert ourselves and to really build a community for our different communities. I think the lens that SIPA sees that work through is, this weekend we're actually celebrating the 20th anniversary of the civil unrest in Los Angeles, the riots that took place in 1992. And if anything that those events taught us, if nothing else, is that it's not enough just to kind of look within our community and to look to kind of build our community. If we aren't doing that in a way that helps other communities, that helps other residents of historic Filipino town, that helps other communities surrounding our neighborhood, then it doesn't really, it won't really lead to the long-term kind of political empowerment, economic development, and so forth that we want to see. At least that's SIPA's lens. So I think that's our approach to want to do this work, is how do we build something for the Filipino community that helps all the communities?
I guess I get the last word in. As you heard, you know, transformation and change is endemic. It's endemic at the individual level in terms of identity, belonging, It happens at the neighborhood level, whether it's gentrification or transformation of the economic base. It happens to communities that may not be spatial, that reside in a social space or in a cultural space. And so it's happening. I think the challenge before us is how do we become active participants in that transformation and change? How do we develop a vision or a set of visions that sort of guide where we want to go? And that takes discussion among stakeholders. And I think the final point is not to be trapped by thinking there's a single panacea. I think we have to be pragmatic and seize opportunities as they come about. We need to figure out how to navigate and negotiate the structures. And when there's a crisis, to respond to those crises, when there's an opening, go through those openings. And that takes hard work. And I actually have no answer other than the fact that I have realized it's just hard work. With that, I want to thank the audience, and let's give them a hand.